has blessed us on tonight. All of this great praise and preaching that's taking place. We commend Hayward, Barclay, for the great job they've done in hosting this lectureship. To those who have preached on tonight, we say to them a job well done. My better half is here, my wife, my best friend, my girlfriend, all that stuff. She's every step asks if she would hold her hand up. The intensity of his storms continued to escalate when he was struck with ulcerous boils from the sole of his feet to the crown of his head. As Job sits among the ashes with his shaven head and torn clothing, soothing himself with his posture, he begins lamenting his afflictions. Job shows us how easily we can become disoriented in our dreadfulness. For in Job, we hear and feel the certain agony of his pain. But Job wants the pain to end. He says in chapter 3, why is light given to him who lives in misery? And life to the bitter of soul who long for death, but it does not come, and search for it more than hidden treasures. Job's storm exacerbates as he listens to his accusers, erroneous Eliphaz, bold Bildad, and zombie-like Zophar. They were comfortless critics, determined to expose Job's assumed and unacknowledged guilt. Their tireless teaching and false theology of retribution robbed Job of any meaningful or real comfort, guidance, and support. In the text, Job is having his storm. He had no idea of God's missio dei. The missiological purpose of God in the book of Job is often overlooked. For although the book of Job does concern humanity's response to the sovereignty of God, it more so addresses the redemptive purpose of God. It is not only a book about the catastrophic tragedies of human suffering, but it is also about the saving mission of God. All right. The Latin term missio dei refers to the sending of God. For God is a missionary. Yeah. His missio dei is active and witnessed in the entirety of history. For God sovereignly controls and directs the world. Missio dei is God's self revelation as one who loves the world. God's involvement in and with the world, the nature and activity of God, which embraces both the church and the world, and in which the church is privileged to participate. For missio dei enunciates the good news that God is a God for people. And the missionary purpose of the book of Job is to demonstrate a believer's suffering should be understood as a witness not only to God's sovereignty, but also as a witness to God's goodness, God's justice, his grace and love to an unbelieving world. For in his undeserved suffering, Job would become a witness to others of God's and love. Job did not know about the heavenly conversation, but Job was not in this storm because he was guilty or culpable. But Job was in this storm because the Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job that there is none like him on the earth?" Job did not realize that he had been picked out to be picked on, that he had been assigned to experience his affliction. He did not understand that he had been sentenced to suffer, that he had been appointed to this adversity, that he had been drafted for this discomfort, elected for this emaciation, charged for this cheerlessness, commissioned to have this confrontation, deputized for this distress. Job was unaware that he had been ordained for this ordeal, selected for this storm, entrusted with this egregious experience, nominated for the nefarious, tagged for these trials, mandated for this misery, chosen for this crushing, called for this crucible, and handpicked for this hardship. It is necessary that all of us must pass through some storms so God can get some glory while we're on our way to glory. We need to realize some of the so-called defects, deficits, and disasters in our lives are really by God's design. For God wants others to see him in us. They often see God in us by how we talk and how we walk in our storms. But Job was not allowing others to see God in him while he was defending himself and accusing God of injustice. For Job wanted to have his day in court with our Lord. Job began to unravel in his storm. His ship of faith is filling with fraudulent beliefs, thoughts, and feelings. He's in the deep waters of divine intention.
Come on.
Earlier in his voyage, in the uncharted waters of suffering, Job successfully trimmed his sails by not sinning with his lips or charging God with wrong. But as the undeserved suffering progressed, Job found himself in desperate need of an anchor. Job was being rocked by the force of his suffering. This man was being destabilized by his distress. The foundation of his faith was beginning to flood. He needed an anchor to neutralize his negativity. He needed an anchor to limit his loathing. Does anybody in here tonight know what it's like to experience instability? Do you know what it's like for your sanity to be shaken, for your decisions to be dubious, for your prayers to be precarious, for your condition to be capricious, for your relationships to be rocky, for your situations to be staggering, for your worship to be wobbly, for your witness to be weakened, for your joy to be jittering, your finances to be faltering? Does anybody know what it's like for your family to be fluctuating, your ministry to be mercurial, your trust to be teetering, your understanding to be unsteady, your vision to be volatile, your victories to be vacillating, your spouse to be unpredictable, your child to be unstable, your health to be unsound, your psyche to be unsettled, your self-perception to be insecure, your teachers to be temperamental, your tomorrow to be tumultuous, and your realities to be rickety? Does anybody know what it's like to experience instability in your life? Job began to unravel during this storm. And Job needs an anchoring voice. Job is anchored, first of all, by the revelation of God's deity. He's anchored by the revelation of God's deity. Sometimes God has to show up just to remind us that he's still God. Job is undoubtedly in a storm. It was earlier in a great wind, a storm that took his children's lives. Imagine what may be going on in Job's mind. For the Lord, why would you show up in a way that reminds me of my suffering? My children died in a storm, and now after all this time, I've been pleading with you, I've been calling out to you, and now after all of this time, you know. You know your hurts are healing when the things and situations that used to trigger your pain no longer set off that pain like they once did. Yeah. In reality, the two circumstances are really entirely different. For the first wind brought ruin, but this whirlwind brought revelation. Yeah. The first wind brought sorrow, but this whirlwind will bring salvation. Yeah. The first wind brought pain, but this whirlwind will bring penance. The first one brought destruction, but this one will bring deliverance. Come Do sir. Not make the mistake of putting God into a box of your own making. Yeah. Do not associate every storm with suffering. Our lives are not suffering. Some people make the mistake of defining themselves by their accomplishment, while other people define themselves by their losses and their suffering. When this occurs, in either case, they become stuck. And Job was stuck in his suffering in part because he identified too closely with his suffering. The Lord identified Job as my servant Job, but Job then identified himself as God's enemy in Job 13, verse 24. Right. You see, the Lord was in control of the first storm, and the Lord was in this storm. Whatever storm you are in, know the Lord is in control of the storm. Right. In fact, the Lord himself may be in the storm. You are Lord. You are Almighty. You could have showed up any way you wanted to. You could have spoken through the posture. The Lord often revealed himself in storms, winds, thunderings, and lightnings. God reveals himself in such ways at times to symbolize the awesome and glorious effects of his presence. God reveals and God conceals himself at the same time. He reveals his back and conceals his face at the same time. God reveals what we need to know and conceals what we cannot know at the same time. Job 36, 26 says, "Behold, God is great and we do not know him, nor can the number of his years be discovered." Job 37, beginning at verse 22, he comes from the north as a golden splendor with God is often awesome majesty. As for the Almighty, we cannot find him. He is excellent in power, in judgment, and abundant justice. He does not oppress, therefore men fear him. He shows no partiality to any who are wise of heart. The voice of the Lord anchors Job through revelation. There's something about the Lord's voice. In Job 37, beginning at verse number 1, the text says, "At this also my heart trembles and leaps from its place. Hear attentively the thunder of his voice and the rumbling that comes from his mouth. He sends it forth under the whole heaven, his lightning to the ends of the earth. After it, a voice roars. He thunders with his majestic voice, and he does not restrain them when his voice is heard. God thunders marvelously with his voice. He does great things which we cannot comprehend." We cannot comprehend, but we know that he is in control. We don't need to comprehend everything because he is in control. Our heartaches are in his hands. Our adversities are under his authority. Our sufferings are under his supervision. Our outcomes are under his oversight. Our maladies are under his management. Our dilemmas are under his dominion. Our problems are under his power. Our grief is under his guidance. Our losses are under his love. Our miseries are under his mercy. And our pains are under his providence. Job is not only anchored by God's revelation or the revelation of his deity, but Job is also anchored by the refutation of false doctrine. In Job 38 and verse 2, text says, "Who is this who darkens counsel by words without knowledge?" The Lord accused Job of clouding the truth about himself.
Well,
by saying things that were not true about God.
Well,
although a believer, Job struggled with his own false doctrine concerning God. Job should have defended God's justice rather than denying God's justice, since he claimed to be a righteous man. Job's lack of adequate revelation led him to this error. Likewise, every believer should be slow to affirm that he knows God's will about the affairs of an individual's life, whether it be his own or someone else's. We still do not know all the facts concerning why God is allowing what takes place in our lives. You see, false doctrine is being refuted in the book of Job. The negative side of the false doctrine is known as retribution theology, which posits wicked people are always punished in this life. The positive side of the false doctrine is known as compensation or prosperity theology, which posits righteous people are always rewarded and prosper in this life. You see, the false doctrine actually originated with Satan. However, it was a common belief in Job's world. Job, his wife, and his three friends all believed in this false doctrine. They all believed God was subject to act according to this predictive rule. Job's friends therefore insist on his guilt because they believe that he would not be suffering otherwise. Job, on the other hand, believes God is being unfair or unjust with him. Job believes God is bound to bless him because Job has been good and has kept the rules. Believing life is fair is an indicative marker of immaturity. Children believe life is fair. Life isn't fair. And we really don't want life to be that way. The Lord demonstrates his rejection of this false doctrine and corrects Job through a series of rhetorical questions. The Lord never mentions the false doctrine directly. Instead, the Lord questions Job about cosmology, oceanography, meteorology, and astronomy to demonstrate Job's ignorance and therefore his inability to contend with the Lord. The Lord speaks during Job's storm. Job's suffering is no longer the focus or the topic of discussion when God speaks. Job did not appreciate that the Lord was the only one that could save him.
Well,
and church, we must understand that you cannot save yourself. Listen to what he says, beginning in Job chapter 40. Would you indeed annul my judgment, God says? Would you condemn me that you may be justified? Have you an arm like God, or can you thunder with a voice like his? Then if so, adorn yourself with majesty and splendor. Array yourself with glory and beauty. Disperse the rage of your wrath. Look on everyone who is proud and humble him. Look on everyone who is proud and bring him low. Tread down the wicked in their place. Hide them in the dust together. Bind their faces in hidden darkness. Then I will also confess to you that your own right hand can save you. God says to Job, if you can't do any of that, then you have no right and no ability to believe that you can contend with me and save yourself. The Lord wants us to turn to him with faith and trust him during our storms rather than tell everyone how unfair he is for arranging or allowing the suffering and trials in our lives. God isn't being unfair because he has allowed or arranged adversity in your life or in your ministry. But we cannot complain about suffering and achieve acceptance of our suffering at the same time.
Amen.
Job finally is anchored by the removal of doubt. Job had begun to doubt the justice of God. Job had begun to wonder if there was really no benefit to worshiping the Lord.
Huh.
The Lord speaks to Job in the storm. And there's no mention of the Lord speaking to Job before his storm.
Huh.
But the Lord speaks to Job during his storm. The Lord speaks to Job while he is yet covered in ulcerous boils and odorous boils.
Man, man.
The Lord speaks to Job when he's clothed in sackcloth with a shaven head. Yeah. The Lord speaks to Job while he remains in a condition of calamity.
My, my.
Job was talking smack in his suffering. He wanted a piece of God. He wanted to have an audience with the Lord.
Wow.
He said in Job 31:7, I would declare to him the number of my steps like on a branch I would approach him. Job now sees himself in comparison to the majesty of the Lord. And he says in chapter 40:4-5, behold, I am vile. What shall I answer you? I lay my hand over my mouth. Once I've spoken, but I will not answer. Yes, twice, but I will proceed no further. Job no longer doubts the infinite power and knowledge of God. Job says, I have no answer. And he puts his hand over his mouth. And we ought to give it up to Job because he knew when to shut his mouth. After hearing God speak, there was nothing more to say. And I'm thankful tonight to have a gracious, merciful, loving, powerful, wise, just, and kind God that will speak to us in our storms. That's good for me to know that he's not silent in our sufferings, that he's not silent in our strains, that he's not silent in our sins, that he's not silent in our situations, that he's not silent in our stress, that he's not hushed in our hard times, that he's not muted in our misfortunes, that he's not wordless in our weariness, that he's not voiceless in our valleys, that he's not unheard in our undoing, that he's not faint in our frustrations, that he's not closed mouthed in our calamities, that he's not buttoned up in our brokenness. I don't know about you, but the Lord speaks to me in my storms. Don't look at me cross-eyed tonight. Yeah, I said the Lord speaks to me in my storms.
Yeah.
Psalm 27:1,
yeah.
Speak, Lord.
Yeah.
The Lord is my light and my salvation.
Yeah.
Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Speak, Lord. Psalm 30:5. For his anger is but for a moment. His favor is light. Weeping may endure for a night,
yeah.
But joy comes in the morning. Speak, Lord. Psalm 34:19. Many are the afflictions of the righteous,
yeah.
But the Lord delivers them out of them all. Speak, Lord. Psalm 37:25. I've been young and now I'm old, yet I've not seen the righteous forsaken, neither seed begging bread.
Yeah.
Speak, Lord. John 14. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me.
Yeah.
In my father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Speak, Lord. John 16:33.
Yeah.
These things I've spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I overcome the world. Speak, Lord. Chapter 1, beginning at verse 1, God, who in various times and in various ways spoke in servant, Job.
Job, sir.
Job, you need to understand some things. Stop listening to Eliphaz. Stop listening to Bildad. Stop listening to Zophar. And listen to me. In your storm, you got to listen to the Lord. Stop listening to the erroneous Eliphaz. Stop listening to Bold Bildad. Jesus tonight, to be anchored in the Lord. In this life, you're going to experience some storms. You're going to have some disappointments. You're going to have some heartaches. You're going to have some failures in this life. And when the storms of life start raging, you need an anchor. The psychiatrist can't do it. The sociologist can't do it. Money can't do it. You need an anchor for your soul. Jesus is that anchor. Won't you come to him? Won't you put your faith in Jesus Christ, the one who died on Calvary's cross, was buried in a borrowed tomb, yet got up with all power in his hands? Won't you come and put your faith in him? Won't you come repenting of the sin? Won't you come tonight confessing with your mouth what your heart believes, that he is the Savior of the world, the Son of God? Won't you be baptized in this fall of remission of sins and get your anchor deep?
Yeah.
One of the things about anchor is underneath.
Yeah.
The storm is experienced from above, but the anchor is beneath. And folk may not understand why you are unmoved by the storms in your life. That's because you got an anchor. It's an anchor that they can't see, but he's deep. He's deep, and strong winds come, and strong winds may blow, and adversity comes, and you shake a little bit, you shake and move a little bit, but your anchor.